What's up, y'all? This is day 281, Making Songbringer. And sorry, I'm a little sick today, so I might not be super agile mentally. But today I'm going to make Poison. What's up, Timescar? Jules? How to do? What's up, y'all? Yesterday I was working on all these new effects and stuff for the all the different swords and the sound effects and all that. This is the poison sword, so I got a few little particles and effects going, and I want to make this so things get poisoned now. So they'll turn green for a minute, and then they'll get hurt a few times and all that. What's up, J2? What's this link, man? Ewok pillow fight. That's pretty good, dude. Oh yeah, nice. What's up, Marengia? Oh yeah, well, the poison effect's looking alright. The ice effects and fire effects, all those things are looking good, but I think it could look even better if these things would leave a trail of stuff on the ground. That would be freaking awesome. So they like maybe would drop some acid or something like that and it would sizzle on the ground. Maybe it wouldn't hurt any enemies or anything, but it would just be a nice visual effect to have something left behind, even if it's momentarily, you know, like a little bit of acid sizzling on the ground for maybe 5 or 10 seconds. I think that would really take this effect over the top, make it even better. But that's not what I'm working on just yet. So I want to work on the actual mechanics of poisoning enemies. So in health system, what's up, Velzan? Good day, mate. How's the land of Oz today? Here's this method where here's the elemental properties of getting an enemy hit. So here's where it freezes enemies, creates fire. So we do something similar for poison. Oh, there's lightning. So let's put this below lightning. So if the changer, which is in this case the ghost sword, if it has the flag poison and the enemy or whatever entity is being attacked does not immune flag, then we're going to poison this enemy. And I want to take a look at how it freezes. That's right. Yeah, okay, so similar to freezing, I want to set the HP delta here to 0, and then we'll just call the poison method. Great, so we're handing everything else off to poison. We make sure HP delta is 0 so that it doesn't actually hurt the enemy then. It's hot today. Oh, yeah, you were mentioning how hot it was over there. Yeah, it's nice and cool here now. We got lots of rain, which is like freaking awesome. California needed rain so bad. We were desperate for rain. Oh, that's one thing though. Shoot, we do need a flag. I guess we could do a render flag. Yeah, okay. We'll do a render flag. So let me click pile that. And then constants, we have render flags where, you know, because an enemy is going to turn green while they're poisoned, or maybe they flash green or something like that. So here's frozen. Let's do something similar for poisoned. Let's get that compiling. And then in constants, we want to make sure we can Whoa. Constance. Oh yeah, like I said, don't start if you're just starting out with shaders, so don't start with color palette swapping. It's a difficult thing. Start with something really simple, like just brightness shader. And you know, I know at first you know GLSL is kind of hard, but check out Shaderific. That might help you learn a little bit. Shaderific.com. It's got some basics and stuff like that. It's on there. They go you go to GLSL, and then you know they got lists of built-in functions you can look at and stuff like that. But whatever your game engine is you're working with, what game engine are you working with, by the way? Whatever it is, figure out how to do their shaders and do a very basic shader, and you'll have a lot more confidence about it, you know. And then, you know, if you still want to do it, then you can move on doing color palette swapping. But honestly, you don't even need to do color palette swapping if you just do different sprites. So I was trying to go to constants.cpp and add. I want to add this new flag. So this can be parsed from the command line if necessary, or from data. So an entity, for example, could start off poisoned from the moment they're created. Right. I want to look at all the other places that are using frozen already. Yeah, it's mostly in health system. There's one here in render system. Okay, yeah, we don't need to focus on that. It's really just in health system. What's up, Henko? Yeah, Merry Christmas, man. Happy holidays. Working on poison here. We can so enemies can get poisoned, and also players can be able to be poisoned and all that. Nice, cool, man. You just started with GLSL? You got the basics sorted. That's awesome. That's what I'm trying to say here. Once you get the basics sorted out, then it's like you've got the foundation. You got your road is clear. Know, you're able to proceed forward. Okay, so I'm gonna kind of mimic how frozen or freezing an enemy works. First, it checks that the enemy's not already frozen. Yeah, you would have to create an entirely new tile set. Okay, so if we're not already poisoned. Let's see if we can just change the color of the enemy. So we're gonna add the poison flag. Just change the color. If you use the shader, you'd have to use grayscale. No, not necessarily. No, you wouldn't have to use grayscale. If you're doing color palette swapping, you normally would just start with, well, actually you could do it either way. You could start with the grayscale and then map grayscale to certain colors, or you can just start with the current colors and map those to different colors. So you don't necessarily have to do grayscale color palette swapping. Once again, that boils down to your implementation of it too. Oh, the stream froze right then. What I was saying was no, not necessarily. Grayscale is not necessarily needed. Oh, Evermore's got a great suggestion there too. Yeah, you could just do your color palette swapping when you load the tiles. Sometimes that's gonna be a lot easier because you've already got the data for the tiles. You could just go switch all the texture data first. Yes, exactly. Nice suggestion, Evermore. So I'm gonna get the color of poison. Yeah, what's up, Boogie? Hey guys. So we're gonna get the item color of item poison sword. So there, we set the color of this entity. Let's get an overall duration. How long will they be poisoned? Maybe start with 3 seconds. And this is gonna where we're gonna schedule a function which resets the entity's color, really, and flags. Take off the poison flag. So we're removing poisoned. And we're setting the color back to white. And I hope this works because I think there's something already which sets the color of a sprite to be white all, like all the time or as necessary. Think that might already be part of the render system. So let's see if this even works. There. So we got a simple poison. It's not going to do anything to actually hurt the enemy just yet. Yeah, poisons for both. Yeah, both enemies and good guys. In this instance, this is going to be the ghost sword throwing out poison onto enemies when it hits them. So the ghost sword can never hit the player or Jib. So really, it's only meant for baddies in this sense. But this poison could work for your player too. So maybe the player gets poisoned somehow, or enemies can do some kind of poison attack. So both. All right, yeah, there. We got a green. That guy's poisoned. Oh, now he's not poisoned. Looks like I might do a special shader for that because not really bright enough. Let's try making this a little brighter. Applying like 1.5 times the tone. Next thing I'll just make it so it hurts the enemy over time. So, every half a second or maybe one, yeah, maybe we're like every second hurts the enemy. Do I think you should write an editor? No, not at all. I don't. I think that'll take way too long to write an editor first. Yeah, it's a small game. That's a little bit more poisony, less dark. But I mean, it's up to you, Jules. You might want to write an editor. It might be the best thing to do. But I'll tell you, the editors take a long time to write. And you don't necessarily have to hard code it. You could just write it in text or in data, so store it in some simple text, and then it's not over. You haven't hard coded your overworld. And the same thing with the dungeons. You could just store them as text. Moringia, what would you think about a game that's like Risk of Rain, but characters and a market based on League of Legends? Risk of Rain was a side scroller, but with I haven't played Risk of Rain. Let me remember what that is again. Was like a procedural RPG, but it was side scrolling. Marangia, big question here on your idea. How do you intend to monetize this? Is this going to be free to play, or is this going to be a paid game? That kind of says a lot. And also, do you want to make money with this? Because that totally would change my answer. What's up, Scottish Pizza? You're having connection problems? You're back. Boogie's back. Yeah, I don't know. I think other people are having connection problems too. Let me see. Is there anything I can do? Looks like everything's awesome right here. We've been live the whole time and only two drop frames. That's amazing. So it looks like we're okay here. Yeah, Veil's End brings up a good point too, but I would just if you already got your game running, and I wouldn't use Tiled personally. I would just code. I would just write it in text, seriously. Or Tiled, either way you want to do that. If you want to go switch to using a map editor. What's up, TM? Yo. And this is all your own opinion too. Whatever you want to do, whatever works best for you. Christmas Eve in 6 minutes. I forgot it's so soon for you guys. There's so few people that watch here on the West Coast. Okay, so next thing, we just make these so the enemies get hurt over time. Yeah, I'm kind of meh on XML too. Oh, it can do multiple formats, huh? Oh, nice. Yeah, I used to use Tiled for my old games. It's actually a really great editor. It really is, and it keeps getting better. He keeps updating it. It's one dude that makes it, and he's a pretty cool guy. Okay, so let's schedule some damage. We've got an overall duration. Oh, let's make a float for damage interval, and let's get damage. Think just one. We could do schedule before tick with multiple. Actually. It's been Christmas Eve for ages here, yeah. It's so crazy. I love it. I've loved doing live streaming and being aware of other time zones. It's cool to know what you guys are experiencing versus what we're experiencing here in this neck of the woods on our increasingly smaller planet, which feels like. The Jason's messy? Oh, I haven't seen a dude Jason. Yeah, you get presents before everybody. Oh, nice. Cool. I like that. I like different traditions and stuff. Happy holidays, everybody. Wait, what was that? Delay? Delay zero. Interval. Oh, wait, we want to go. The delay is actually the damage interval. So the first call here is going to be after a minute. And then the interval is also damage interval. And let's do damage count as well. Right, so we just get the current this entity and damage it. Easy. And capture the damage. And actually, this would be more like L round, or no, CLF of, oh yeah, negative 0.25 times K life. Per container. So this is gonna do three-fourths of a heart of damage. I pray to the gods of random number generation. Yeah. How about the I believe in science. You know what I mean? That guy from Nacho Libre. What was his name? Changer. All right, there. Oh, changer. Yeah, it should be negative damage. Thanks, Tom. Yep. Yeah, I know that's wrong, huh? It really should just be HP Delta, the name of that. It's kind of misleading, so let's do that. HP Delta. What's up, Tom? Peach? It's already minus VE. Yeah. Oh, but also this should not be CLEF. Floor F now. Because it's negative. Right. Which this should come out to be negative one. Maybe I should check that. Yeah, let's do a breakpoint. Check that. Oh, minus VE is a negative? Oh, my negative. Oh, I've never known that shorthand. Cool. Ah, I learned something new today. Minus VE, I'm trying to associate that mentally. Minus VE is negative. I get it. Okay, HP Delta, negative one, good. Let's see if it works now. So we should be able to hit an enemy with this poison sword and then have them get hit, like hurt, like three times. That's cool, you can see him underground getting damaged. Oh, there's some guys getting. Yes, that's cool. So far, I've given it a little bit more damage than the other swords because it happens over time. So this does the poison sword does three quarters of a heart or whatever, a tooth of damage. The ice sword does half a heart of damage, but that's when the enemy thaws. Oh, and that's positive. Oh. Every time I walk back upon the back of a dark knight in Zelda 1, it turns its direction to face me. Like Baelzin's comment after that. Plant a bomb when they're underground? Good idea. That sounds fun. Let's make sure we got bombs all queued up. We should have bombs too. Bomb container one. Bomb. Yeah, a hint that they can end. Yeah. Yeah, J2, there's poison bombs already. Yep. I just have to implement them. So that's gonna be the next thing. So I got poison swords. You can also have a poison top hat. Right now I have the frozen top hat. There's no effects or anything, so maybe tomorrow I'll start working on the different top hats, and then the next day I'll start working on the different bombs. But yeah, poison bombs have always been on the list to do. Oh, you can poison them while they're frozen. That's cool. I like these snacking effects. Man, that's... Oh, there he is. Killed him. Let's try that one more time. This is fun. Yeah, it does it for the ice already. Yeah, I could do something similar for poison. Probably just make him flash from green to not green. Oh, I froze him. Going to ground. There he is. Oh, I lost track of him. This is really hard to bomb an enemy that's underground. Yeah. Well, I'm sure that's possible. There should be some kind of achievement. You bombed an enemy that's underground while they were poisoned. Yeah, they move around while they're underground. Watch the see, they turn to be gray. See a little gray guy? Gray square? And then they turn back to red once they come back up. So yeah, they're there. They're moving around while they're underground. They still don't move onto like any kind of, you know, collision or whatever. Okay, let's make them flicker a little bit before they end their poison thing. This is how it does. Wait, where is it? Oh, here's where it thaws out. Thawing is basically just running a flash. Let's try running a little flash before, or right when it finishes. So it'll change the color back, and then it'll flash for a minute. Yeah, probably 1 second's good. Bomb bait. Oh, bomb bait. That's great idea. I love that. Bomb bait. Maybe there's certain enemies that automatically want to go attack a bomb. They're like, no, bombs, yummy. They're like bomb weak. There's no bait in the game yet. That's a really great idea. I love this bait. Oh, that was a little too short. Yeah, good point, J2. What's up, Pema? Just add water, right? Enemies that explode near you? Oh, yeah, those kind of enemies. Those are, yeah. I love that. An enemy that eats bombs and charges towards you. And maybe there's a dumb version of that enemy that eats bombs and blows themselves up. That would be fun. You have a question, sort of a preference, Yeah, I like to dongo. So you have two classes, player and enemy. You want the player to take damage from the enemy. Right? Where would you put the logic for this? The player go, hey, enemy hit me, I should lose health. The enemy go, hey, I hit player, I'll lose someone's health. Or a third manager out there go, hey, player and enemy collide with each other, I should extract some of the player's health. Yeah, well, first of all, I would say this. You shouldn't be thinking of classes. But I mean, this is kind of an advanced concept, but let me throw this out there just for you to start thinking about. Because if you're writing your game with a player class and an enemy class and thinking of some third manager class, you're thinking object-oriented, and that used to be a good thing, but if you've ever tried a entity component system, you start to realize how awesome entity component systems are. You don't have to have these player classes and enemy classes. You don't have to write new code for new enemies and stuff like that. So, I would first of all start looking at entity component design, and you can look at Ray Wenderlich's article. It's kind of a good one to start with. Here it is, an introduction to component-based architecture in games. And this will change your whole paradigm, your whole world, and it will really simplify the way you write games. And this will automatically answer your question right there. Of course, you're going to use the third manager, which manages all your entities and manages your collisions. But let me post this link for you first. But yeah, if you are going to go down the road of using objects, that's fine. It's totally fine. And in fact, it may be the best thing right now. Using a object-oriented system might be the best thing for your game or your current level of understanding and stuff like that. It just takes a while to actually even understand how the heck these even work, and it may not be right for you to do this. So if you are going to use objects, I would suggest using a third manager that's going to be the manager that basically handles collisions. And then it is the thing that detects collisions. And but really, Pema, it really doesn't matter. In the end, you could do it all three of those ways. Any one of those will work. So yeah, but I hope that helped. Did that help? Did that all come through? Did the stream just die or anything? It's all right. Right. Yeah. Exactly. Collision systems handles collisions for everything that has a collision component. Yeah. Cool. All right, man. Yeah, just keep that in mind. Keep that in mind, and remember that all three of those ways are fine. Right. So this is unpoison. This is poison damage. Let's try a whole 2.0 on the tone. What kind of laptop am I using? I got a MacBook Pro from 2013. It's a great laptop. It's not awesome for playing games because 3D games and all that kind of stuff, and they use a lot of GPU. And this thing's fan will go off like crazy if I'm playing any kind of 3D game. So that's actually one reason why I prefer 2D games, I guess. So I don't like hearing my fan go off. But yeah, it's a MacBook Pro 2013 model, and it's got a solid state hard drive. That's one of the raddest things. It's got a Retina display, which I'll never ever go back to using non-Retina displays. I mean, Retina displays, oh my God. Looking at regular laptop displays or regular computer displays to me now looks horrible. It looks ugly. So yeah, I highly recommend those. I believe that Macs make a really awesome hardware. It's just a really dope computer. This thing is just very well designed. So I prefer them. But I know it's expensive overseas to, to get these, so. Is it still expensive to get these overseas? That'll work. This is kind of the basics of having poison. I guess I think I'd like to do a shader. Making enemy like bright and stuff. Yeah, they're pricey, huh? Oh yeah, Veils In. Let me just I can recap. There's that link there on Entity Component System Design. I would, if you're, yeah, this is such a great thing. Entity component systems will change your entire paradigm about how you think about games. And my opinion now is I've used entity object-oriented systems for 20 years. 20 years of game development, I always wrote objects. Like I would have a player object, an enemy object. Enemy objects were subclassed into like a billion other things. The player and the enemy were subclassed from character. And then I found entity component systems and I will never ever go back. They're just so awesome. Oh, you just use them yourself? Oh, cool. All right, nice. I'm glad you do. Yeah, Retina displays, you can't see the pixels at all. You can actually. If you look really close, you can see the pixels, but like it's hard. Oh, it's £1,000 for a MacBook? Yeah. I think that's similar to our prices. And what's a new MacBook Pro going for these days? In the United States. Where'd they move it to? Oh, Mac. Yeah, they are expensive everywhere, right? MacBook Pro. Yeah, these are $1,300. Okay, so they do price it up for you guys by £125. The cost of exports. What's up, baby? All right, so what next? What next with this whole thing? For demonstration purposes, do you have a list of the types of systems and components you use in Songbird? Yeah, I could show you. Yeah, let me show you kind of, I'll break down how the entities and systems and stuff like that work. And the best, basically I can just go to, here's all the systems. Let's look at components first. Here's all the components. There's AI component, which AI, it's kind of sucks, but my AI has two different modes. There's a mood behavior mode or mood mode where enemies kind of get into a certain mood and the mood has a function which runs. And then there's also behavior where they use behavior trees, which is way better. I don't have to write code for enemies. So most of the enemies use behaviors. There's attack component, which just basically is your melee attack. There's collision components. There's the overall component. There's dialogue components, door components. There's entity foo, which is the entity component system that I wrote for this game and then put on GitHub. So it's there on GitHub if you want to check us out, C++. There's exit components, gear components, which hold, a bunch of different items. There's health components, input component, there's item components, light components, move components, name components, position components, profile components, which is like a bunch of different, it holds like a bunch of different animations and sounds and stuff like that. There's reflection components, which add a reflection to an entity. Render component, of course, is just the sprite. Secret component, which basically says that this is like a secret and it's invisible. There's a shadow component, which is just the shadow for every entity. Yeah, I hope that makes Vils, and any other questions, let me know. I would love to share with this. Demlar, what's up, man? What's your question? Yeah, Demlar, I see all your posts here, but I don't see your question. So please ask it again. Yeah, totally, right? Getting one more soldered into your MacBook costs a fortune. You're just talking about the MacBook, huh? Yeah. What's up, Red Sands? Yeah, Demlar, once again, I just looked through all these posts here. I don't see your question. What's up, Ethan? How you doing, man? Okay, so I'm really happy with this so far. We got poisonable entities. Let's see what happens when the player gets poisoned. I think it's possible to do that by just changing the Zurb's profile. So if we go to the Zurb profile, we've got collision, flags, poison. I think that's all we need. Let's see if that's right. Constants. Poison. Yeah, K collision poison. I think this might work. So now if I go and touch an enemy, any one of these Zurbs, we should be poisoned. Oh, nice. Oh, but that did, what that did is it made it so I'm not even damaged by them. Oh, and I'm not even hurt. That's weird. A gyps poison. All right, okay, let's work on this. So back to health system. You're looking through documentation regarding creation of a window. Some options I've seen is Win32, SDL, looking for a C++ or C option that won't have to be the main in my application. Yeah, look at GLFW. Go, dude, this is, GLFW is awesome because it's cross-platform. GLFW.org. You got that, Demler? GLFW.org. I would recommend this. Or actually, it would be even better if you used a cross-platform game engine. But this would probably be a good start for your question. Nice, Ethan. Good job, man. The rich man's Acer. Yeah, Ethan, of course. You can always post your links. Post your link to the song is fine. Yeah, totally. SDL. LibGDX. Okay, if it's just for an application. Yeah, GLFW, man. Demlar, did you see what I said? I'm just going to post it in the chat because I'm not hearing any reply from you about it. There you go. All right, so we were seeing, Jib got poisoned. The player got poisoned but didn't get damaged. That was weird. Let's see what happens when we get this callback. So I'll go step on an enemy. I should get a call back here in a second. There we go. And what's going on here? Why is he not getting hurt? He shouldn't be invincible. Yid's okay. It's not invincible. HP Delta should be less than zero. We got negative one. That's good. Shouldn't be dormant. Not a locked item. Oh, it's the changer. Okay. It keeps poisoning the player. That's what's up. So this, I think this might need to be zero, actually. Let's see what what happens if that's zero. Are you anding the destructor to remove it? What's up, Sam's number one fan? What are you talking about? Anding the destructor to remove what? Ethan, I'm working on poison today. Wait, so let's get poisoned. Oh, there we go. Nice, Jib can get poisoned. Oh, that's great. Okay, now let's make sure that the poison still works for the enemies. Oh, I totally see this guy underground. Get him! Alright, yeah, this is all working good now. Sweet. Don't see programmers shun Lua. Evermore, good reply. Who cares? Just use whatever you want. Totally, man. And there, yeah, Evermore's got a good reply there too. There probably are C bindings for every scripting language. It's true. Pretty sure there are C bindings for almost every scripting language out there. Nice, Ethan. Dude, why use Notepad plus plus when you got Notepad minus minus? Okay, this is a good initial starting point. I'm gonna check this in so far. I like this. The poison's working. Poison's works for the enemy. Oh, wait, we want to take it off of the Zurb. So it's not gonna, you know, get poisoned from these guys anymore. And let's make sure all this code that got changed is looking good. We changed the poison. We added a poison flag. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. That's good. Remove some of this old code. Add this poison ability to HP's change delta. There's the poison function. Yeah, we're good. Cool. So we got an initial poison done. All right, next, let's make it awesome. Let's make it look better. Nice, you got a PS4? Right on. I wish I had one of those. Alright, so I want to make it so the sword drops a bunch of little entities on the ground. So it like leaves poison It leaves like a poison trail. Actually, I wonder if we just could add poison trail to the whenever anything gets poisoned. Nims poison trail. Poison particles. There we go. Add this to the entity getting poisoned for the duration of the poison. So let's see what that looks like. Now the enemy should be dropping some of those poison particles, the same as the just like the sword. I don't know what this will look like. But I do want more particles. I want it to actually drop something on the ground that sizzles a little bit. Right, it's kind of cool. Whoa. Guys think? How's this looking? Only thing I would change if I were to keep this in is to make it so that it's like level with the Zurb. It needs to be like lower on the Zurbs. Why? Oh, it does mean you can totally see where they're at underground. Jules, maybe you could add emotions. For example, if you kill an enemy, the enemies that are nearby get scared, and a tear appears over their heads. That's cool. I think that's kind of we had this in our other game, Hero Bash. It's called Panic, and same kind of thing: fear, panic, whatever. That's a cool idea. And in fact, you know what, Jules? I'm probably gonna do that anyways for the fear bomb. So there's lots of bombs, right? And one of them is a fear bomb, and it explodes and makes everybody fearful around you. So that's actually gonna happen. So yeah. Oh, Sam's number one fan? No, that's definitely not a destructor. No. This is a bitwise not operator. Check it out, man. Does this make it clearer if I do that? That's a bit, check it out. Let's look at bitwise, see bitwise operators. It's the negation operator, I'm pretty sure. There you go. Bitwise not. So bitwise not is a ones complement. Basically, it just flips all the bits in something. You got that, Sam's number one fan? These bitwise operators are all pretty important to know if you're going to code in C or C++. So there's AND, which is bitwise AND. There's bitwise OR, XOR, left shift, right shift, and bitwise NOT. Yeah, J2, thanks, man. Maybe poison should fall on a parabolic trajectory? Maybe. Nice, right on. Cool, Sam's number one fan. I'm glad you did. My day's going great, Ethan. Okay, let's try another animation. Go to a Nims and add something for more poison. This is gonna be even more poison. Poison particles. Poison. I want these to be like poison entities or poison trail. Like I want to leave like little bits of acid on the ground. I guess we'll just call it Poison Trail for now. Will Songbringer be on PS Vita? Sorry, I can't answer that just yet. Ask me again in about 6 months. I will have some news, I promise you. So what I want the poison particles or poison trail to do is it like falls down onto the ground and sizzles, just sits there sizzling for a minute. So we'll go to do, let's do, instead of poison particles, do a poison trail. Create it in the enums. We're going to create a poison trail method. I kind of want it to look like ice. Right now, the ice one is pretty cool. It falls to the ground, sort of. So, we'll create a poison trail method. Use the poison sword color. And we'll leave it all, everything else the same for a minute. Starting to use flux already. I want to turn this off. Demlar, have I thought about using hacks? Definitely not. Yes, I have. I've definitely looked into every other engine. I'm very comfortable with Cocoa Studio X. It's already a cross-platform engine. And I know, does Hacks do that for PlayStation Vita or something? I wish I could tell you guys more. I can't say anything right now. Right there. Oh, so it's doing an additive blend. Let's take off the height. So make the height maybe like 4 and take off this additive blend. I just kind of want to leave a trail of poison. Songbringer's coming to Atari. Oh, that would be so hard to backport all the way to like a truly 8-bit system. Every number can only be 255. If it's unsigned. Right. The poison sword. What does it do? The poison particles. Oh, see you, Boogie. Later, man. Yeah, I've already seen hacks. I'm good. I'm definitely not going to change what I'm doing here at this point. I'm already a year into writing this game. Why do you say it's a toolkit? It's an engine, right? Ugh. Yeah, I'm definitely not gonna do, I'm not gonna change the language I'm writing in or any of this stuff. Much is an as Apple license? You mean for like for doing for what? What Apple license? You mean for the iOS App Store or for the Mac Store or some other kind of license? What are you talking about? Oh, hacks generate C code? Okay. Drunk chimpanzee, what's up, man? Hey, I haven't seen you in a while. Have you heard about Learn to Code in 1 Hour by Mojang? I haven't. Is it good? Is it there? Oh, here it is. Okay, yeah. Let's add poison trail as well as poison particles to the sword. Oh, for the iOS App Store? Yeah, it's 99 bucks for a year. So you got to renew it every year. It's 100 bucks. And that's even to publish free apps, you have to pay 100 bucks a year. Okay, let's start making this poison trail look better. So I guess I do want it to start with a height of 14, but then fall to the ground. Here's where it moves by. Negative height, drand F. Let's do 01 there. Okay, so all I want him to do is just fall to the ground. Nice. Yeah, I love all these. We have so many great resources today for learning to code. It's awesome. Oh, there, I did see it like fall to the ground a bit. But I want it to not fade out. Just check out that. So we're gonna create life. And then when it's on the ground, I guess we'll delay life times two for a second. So it'll fall to the ground, it'll have a whole nother lifetime while it's living on the ground, and then I guess it could fade out. Yeah, I should have done the fade out there. Yeah, that's what I wanted. There. Now we got it falling to the ground too. Cool. Great. Yeah. Let's get that to fade out after it falls. And also I want it to color, like get darker. So when it hits the ground, actually we'll delay a lifetime. We'll tint by, I guess tint to, so we're gonna tint to based on another lifetime, and then this is gonna be apply tone to color, make it maybe a quarter of the brightness. What is an auto variable? It's not actually a type. It's just, it means to take on whatever type that is being used there. So if, for example, yeah, it's starting to work. If like look at this. This is how it works. In C, I guess the new C has this, whatever, C++. Let's say this, int I equals 10, float J equal, float F equals 4.4. Auto J equals I. Auto G equals F. All right. Both of these autos right here, all they did was they took on the type of the variable that they already had. So this is still a strongly typed language, right? This is still strongly typed. It just means that this J is also an integer and this G is also a float. It comes in really handy when you're doing, when you have like some, let's say you have a vector of like a map of an integer to a string, and then that's V, and then you want to get the type of its iterator. Like, this is so much easier than this. Watch this. Auto it equals V dot begin. Right, that's great. Check this out though. If I were to actually type this out the long way, the old school way, this is horrible. Watch this. Vector map int string iterator it 2 equals v dot begin. See how hard that was? Do you see the benefit of using auto now? Auto is freaking awesome. The only time you don't want to use auto is if it makes your code less readable. But for most cases, auto is just better. That help? Drunk chimpanzee, are you going to change the icon for the poison effect? What icon? What are you talking about? What's up, Rab Ninja? Yes, this is C++. All right, so I'm working on the effect here for the poison trail. This is where you've already got an effect for the poison sword when it shoots out poison, but then see there's little particles that are dropping onto the ground. I want those to look cooler. And for now, I'm going to comment it out for the enemies. So I want them to fall to the ground faster. So right now they have a lifetime of 1 second. I want them to fall to the ground in maybe, I don't know, phi ratio time. We got fall duration. There's the ground duration. Well, so this is while they're on the ground. Let's say they live for another 2 seconds. And then fade duration. They fade out over a second after they've fallen and then left set on the ground for a minute. We need to capture all those. Here we go. We delay time for the falling. We tint. Actually, this tint can do, we can do that while it's falling. So sprite.run action tint to create, and this is over the fall duration. And so it gets black, it gets darker as it falls. After C++ 21 will be out, you've changed your mind. I haven't even heard it's 21, I've heard it's 17. Rap Ninja, yes, this game engine I'm using is called, it does use OpenGL. I'm using an engine called Cocos 2DX. It's a great open source engine, but it's kind of an advanced, not really advanced, but more like intermediate engine. It's kind of a do-it-yourself type of engine. For beginners, I would highly recommend either Game Maker or Unity, both great engines. Coco CDX is more for people that are kind of used to C++ already, and you're just ready to do things yourself, because you're gonna have to do a lot of stuff you're on your own with Coco CDX. So we fall, we fade. Oh, this is fall plus ground. This is fade. And this move by is just the fall duration. Okay, now we got all these variables. We can custom set all these. Rocket Bunny, what's up, buddy? Happy holidays. You're planning on learning SFML? Cool. Awesome. Rocket Bunny, how'd it go, man? Did you talk to your dad? Here we go. We got a little bit of. But I want him to sizzle. At least be smaller, a little smaller. Actually, they should be used. I'm gonna think of using blood instead of pixel for these. In fact, where's the blood at? Blood percent D. Oh yeah. There, so now we're using blood, but we're gonna color it green. So let's see what. Oh no, I think blood actually might be black though. Yeah, this might not work. I guess I could make different colored blood though for this. Well, yeah, it's all black. Oh, and it's scaled too big. You really think GameMaker is great? Yes, I do. You think the prices are high? Oh, really? Oh, see, I've never used GameMaker, so I wouldn't know, but I think for beginners, GameMaker can be really great. But maybe I'm wrong about that. Okay, let's try some white blood. So I'm gonna open up the blood and make it all white. You gonna change the icon for the poison effect, the one by the D key. Let me check out what you're talking about. Oh no, that's not the. Yeah, that I already have that. That's the hat. This is the ice hat. Check it out. It freezes enemies. I haven't even finished this. I haven't even started the art for that. So that's the ice hat. There's already a poison hat. Check it out. If I turn off the ice top hat, I turn on the poison top hat. You see there. Oh, and I changed the binding. Poison. J2, no, they can't be hit by poison. They can't be hit by stuff while they're underground, but they can't if they're already poisoned, then yes, they're gonna I'm gonna keep it that way so they can be poisoned underground. So there you go, yeah. The poison's working all see that? We got a poison hat too. Poison hat. There's ice hat, fire hat. I think there's like a Some other kind of hat too. Okay, so back to creating some, let's create some white. We'll do it with levels. Oh yeah, so the poison sword, I am consider okay, so drunk chimpanzee, I am considering that. I'm not sure what to do about this just yet because the sword, you keep your sword, right? You have a sword and you also have a ghost sword. So you not only have a nano sword, but you have this poison sword device, right? So I guess I could switch the icon for the sword for the F key right up there. So it could show the poison sword instead. On the right here, but I'm not sure what's right here because it's technically you're still using the nano sword. You just have that extra poison sword, but I think it might be clearer if it did switch to using the different colored swords and stuff. It probably would look cooler too. In fact, yeah, let's try that really quick, actually. Where do we equip the sword and all that? I think this is actually takes place in load game. Here it is, set item image. I'll set a little breakpoint. If item equals K, item sword. Just want to see the places where it does this. It's worth a try, right? Changing all the swords to be point whatever the sword is you're using. All right, good night, Jules. You gotta be fit for Christmas? Totally. Yeah. Get it, man. Hope it's fun. Yeah, so set item image is called from the beginning of the game. Yeah, it never ever changes. I think. Oh yeah. Wow. Okay. Let's hook that up the right way then. In here, we've already got the entity. So if the current item is the sword, don't tell me it's nano sword. Sword. Oh, there it is. Sword. So if they have a ghost sword, e.gear.get, I think it's, oh, maybe it's find ghost sword. Actually, yeah, let's. Merry Christmas. Fool's Duty, what's up? How's the game coming? Great, man. How are you doing? There. So that should show the ghost sword on the as equipped. Nice. Yeah, cool. The poison sword that's showing is equipped now. Yeah, it's probably clear, huh? The only thing that's not clear now is that you don't really technically have it equipped. But oh well. I like that. From Boston Dynamics. It's not loading for me, man. Okay, so let's try out this white blood. So if I put the output levels all the way to white here, I go, well, this might be slices. Yeah, it is. Okay, let's save this as white blood. Maybe blood white. All right, so export this. Puts in a common folder, blood white. We should have all these files now, these new files, 0 through 8. Yeah, that's right. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Good. That'll get automatically compiled. We should see it. Rendering, it didn't render, huh? Hammerspoon, man, Hammerspoon just gives up on me. Let's try once again. No love from the Hammerspoon.
Sorry, are you still streaming?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Hi,
That's all
sorry,
right.
guys.
Thanks, Fool City. See if that works. Blood white. Wait, did it repack the textures? I didn't notice. Ah, there it goes. Thing is freaking sketchy. It never works. Sometimes it works, and then sometimes it just doesn't. Gotta reload Hammerspoon. Maybe Hammerspoon's out of date or something. Let's do like a spattery noise too when it hits the ground. All right, so we can do it right here. Instantaneous call phone create. So call phone create. We're gonna take takes nothing. Let's make a splat noise. And there's 2000. Splat. I want to make it also set its local Z order. Oh, this is the sprite. Man, this is kind of complicated. Equals the order 997 or so. They're fading away too fast, though. Oh, that's because it needs the ground duration here. You guys still there? Is the stream still going? Looks like it. Yeah, I loved it. Yeah, totally. Great movie. What's up, Zeiger? Maybe it should stay on the ground a little longer, though. So ground duration 3.333. You saw it twice? Nice. My girl saw it twice, too. I only seen it once, though. But I hear, I'm really excited for the next movies, too, already. I like it leaving a trail, but it maybe should fade slower and actually stay on the ground longer. So maybe 5 seconds, and it fades over like a slow 3 seconds. It stays on the ground long enough for you to forget. You know, I forget for a minute that it's even there. But then it fades after eventually because it's gotta fade. I can't leave thousands of sprites out. I can do the blood, but not quite all these. There's like a ton of these sprites, so this is something where I couldn't just leave it out. So how about Poison Height or Poison Trail? I'll have a height variable. So we can actually pass in the height rather than just saying that it's always going to be 14 or whatever. And that will make it so we can pass in a height and say the ghost sword has a height, a high height, but the enemies have a lower height. Does anyone know how to fix an iPhone charger? I don't know. So actually poison goes almost through all width heights? What? What you saying? So there, now we can have the health system do a poison trail as well with the height that's lower, like maybe 4. And the input system, when it does the poison trail for the sword, it does a higher height, like 14 or so. Concussive therapy. Yeah, what you saying there, J2? I didn't quite understand that. Oh, it has a long distance. Oh, yeah, it has long distance, right. Oh, I think I see what you're saying. Yeah, it goes forever. Yeah, the ghost sword is sort of like an energy thing, so it can go through other objects. Oh, let's see what it sounds like too with the splat. Man, it's compiling slow. Is there something running? Shouldn't be. Oh. Sorry guys, this whole stream. You might have been hearing weird noises because I forgot to hook up my eddies. Sorry for the possibly sore, the bad sound quality today. Yeah, Google. Sound headphones. Okay, so what I'm taking a look at now is the trail poison that an enemy will leave on the ground. That was a lot of poison. Yeah, it's a little too messy, but it's leaving too many particles per enemy. And it really shouldn't be working that way if the category is none. So in enemies, if the enemy's underground, yeah, it's a lot like acid, totally. Maybe this delay per should be less too. So I'll try doubling that. And then I'm gonna try, I think there's a sizzle noise. Splat, sizzle, there's no sizzle. Oh, there is sizzle, yeah, sizzle. I'm gonna try the sizzle noise instead. And oh, also, if the parent, if e.collision.category equals k filter none, we're gonna return. So if an entity is underground, they're not gonna leave a trail of poison or whatever. Let's do less. Still looking really. Oh, did I changed the wrong one. No wonder. There, it's three less. Less delay per. I think it needs to start with the darker color, actually, and not as high. So we'll apply the tone. Here we go. Apply tone. I guess I could make it even darker when it hits the ground. Nah, I like it how dark it is. Let's keep that there. And when Google's no use, dang. When the poison trail, what was the other call? The poison trail again? NIMS health system. Yeah, here we go. Let's do it a little lower there. I think there's maybe one more touch to this, too. I might want to make it so it flies. Ooh, I got to check if you're facing the wrong direction, if it, or the other direction, if it does the right falling. Dang. That sucks. I had that happen to one of my phones too. In fact, it never was able to charge again. But that's because somehow the port or whatever inside the whole iPhone was messed up. Tape it. Oh, you got it to work? Nice. Too many particles. Learned that from Flambeer. So I think this has definitely got a lot of particles. This is looking better. I think this could work. I want that to be a poison trail, and that to be not poison. Oh, now it's not working? Dang. Here, oh, here's the move by. It's DRAND F01 times 6. Yeah, I'm gonna make that 0. Keep it simple. It goes negative height. Yeah. Yeah, totally. Yeah, that's what happened to mine one time. A port actually died. I could never charge my phone again. Wah, wah. I had the option of buying a new port and getting it installed and all that, and it was just cheaper to buy a new phone. But if it's just a charger, then you're good to go. Okay, I got something that can really help this. Slightly varying this color every time. So we're gonna apply a little tone to that color and making it like maybe like 0.8F plus Drand F01 times 0.2F. So now we got a chance to be a little darker. Nice, you get a new phone soon. Sweet. Needs more. So maybe half, maybe 6.64. I just noticed these guys don't have any sound when they come out of the earth. They don't have any burrowing noise. They definitely need a burrowing noise. At least it's the cable, man. That's a tad bit dark, actually. Let's go max color. Maybe 4.4. There's quite a few viewers tonight. You mean there's not very many viewers, or there's a lot of viewers? How do I? Is there some way to see that? What's up, viewers? That's a little bit better. Yeah, I guess that's okay. I think I'm happy with this. I like it. It's all I really wanted was for the sword to leave a trail of poison, as well as its current particles. There's two particle effects going on, and enemies will leave a trail of poison as well. But you know what? No, there's one problem. It starts off at 2,000 on its Z. Sorry, I'm kind of sick, so I can hardly think today. But let's set it to be starting off at negative 997Z, so it's below everything else. Nice. What's up, Wheels Miff? Looks like. Oh, that's nice. That's really nice. Okay, I see what J2 is saying. So J2, check it out. Now when I shoot the sword, the actual poison acid stuff on the ground isn't visible, except for where it should be. And also, let's see, when an enemy leaves a trail of poison. Yeah. That's good. Right, I like it. I like it a lot. It's working great now. Everything's looking good. Really good. So almost ready to check in. I just want to do a sound effect for these guys when they burrow underground. Vidan, how are you going to be able to deploy to consoles with Kokos? Yeah, they don't support consoles. Yeah, there was actually a conversation on the Coco Studio X forum a while ago about that, because they were going to support them, and now they're not. They're definitely not going to support them. It's actually Microsoft's fault. Microsoft like is so restrictive about how they do everything, and also PlayStation is kind of restrictive about how they share their toolkits and stuff like that. So they couldn't. Coco Studio X had the code already written for it to work on Xbox, but because of Microsoft's rules and legalities and all that, they can't actually release it open source. So, man, I wish I could tell you more. I can't really talk about it at this point, but in a few months, check back with me and I'll let you know. But if you were looking at how to do it yourself with Cocos 2DX, you're probably gonna have to kind of Cocos 2DX is already set up kind of cross-platformy and stuff like that, so you really only have to like switch out their renderer. So you would have to kind of write your own renderer. But I'm pretty sure that PlayStation, I'm not sure if they do or not, but I'm pretty sure they use OpenGL-ish code. I'm not sure though. Hey, no, Annette, what's up? Yo. Yeah, right. Microsoft only allows C Sharp. Is that true? I'm pretty sure they allow C++. Yeah, Vadon, I love Cocos as well. Yeah. Oh, Ravro, what's up? Yeah, this whole point system thing just got implemented by one of the viewers. His name is Boogie, and he's awesome. And he made this thing called BotFu. So you can type in this command here. You go exclamation point help, and you can see all the commands that BotFu can do. But yeah, since I know you have been viewing since day 61, which is a long time ago, right? But BotFu's only been around for like a month, so that's why you only have 61 points or whatever. But it's all just based on how much you viewed, you know? Yeah, let's make a sound effect. So I'm gonna make a sound effect for like burrowing or ground or dirt. Let's see if we can find something for the word burrow. There's only two results. You gotta check out the null video. No. Yeah, BotFu is definitely awesome. You rock, BotFu. It works using he wrote it in C sharp, and it works using some cross-platform, not a cross-platform, but a C sharp library for IRC, some kind of, some it's IRC. That's how chat works yeah, it's an IRC bot essentially, right? Thanks, J2. Sorry, I'm not, my brain is real slow today. I'm just kind of sick. Let's try Sound Bible. Look for friendly noises with good licenses. See if we got any kind of burrowing noise or digging would be a good word here too. Hooting owls, pickaxe, maybe? No. No. Let's look for the word dig. This is probably going to be loud. Oh yeah, thanks, A2. That was the one, right? Okay, definitely not. It's too metally. It's too much metal in there. Digging into stones, rock, maybe. Shuffle? Yeah, good suggestion. I'll try that next. Shuffle. Oh, there we go. This one's got some sounds I can use. Sweet. There's just a few little snippets of sound in between those noises, which could really work well here. So I'm gonna get that one. This one might be all right. Let's see. Yeah, shuffle, yeah. Yeah, shuffle. Wet sand digging? No, no, no. Okay, I'll look for shuffle as well while that one's downloading. Domino? No. Shuffling cards? No. Feet shuffling? Maybe. No. 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 Good word, but it just didn't turn out to be the right results. Okay, so let's look at this, edit this up. That's a good one right there. Let's just make this whole thing mono. 44, 16 mono. I'm gonna look for some other, like, not, I'm looking for noises that don't have that metallic shovely noise. That's kind of good. Oh yeah, that's really good right there. That could be good for when it unburrows. I wonder what it would sound like reversed. That kind of even works there too. Let's find some other noises too. This might be good to experiment a little. No. It's more of a shovely noise. I can hear a cow in the background. A little reverb. I'm not a big fan of reverb. Because reverb is great for something when you're indoors or inside a cave or anything when you've got walls and stuff around you. But a lot of this game is outdoors and in the overworld and all that. So reverb can really kind of kill the aesthetic for at least for the overworld. And then when I am indoors, it might be good to add a reverb version, you know, for like when you're in the cave, play this reverb-y version. Or it might even be better to use, you know, a better sound engine. We can add reverb on the fly. But good thought. Always a good thought to try new things. And, you know, reverb is a touchy thing. I've written music for many years, and reverb can be awesome and excellent for some things. And then, you know, some things it's like too much. Yeah, that's that cow noise. Oh, that's a nice one there. That's the cool noise in the background. Ooh, I like this one here. Oh yeah, that's good. Yeah, I like that. Very good noise. Good job, Max Thrower. It's a good recording here. So now I'm just going over the ones I chose. Touch these up. I don't like this right here. Still don't like it. There's something in here that's like really annoying. It's still there. Oh, it's this bit here. Yeah, that's all right. Okay, so we're getting to negative 18 decibels here. Yeah, definitely the last one did sound the most metallic. Will I be streaming tomorrow? Possibly. I'm not sure. Oh, J2. The link's broken, dang. Sturmankin sounds. 939 carpet. Oh, yeah, this is really good. I'm gonna download this one and possibly use that as a backup. It's a good call. And then you got another one here, Sturmankin 278923. Yeah, the problem with these is this one's a little too attacky. There's like too much attack. It's the strength of the, beginning of the sound is really fast and all that. So this one doesn't really work as well, but this one does. So possibly we'll use that, but I'm gonna save these out. So save this one. Oh, we got to negative 18. Negative 18 is probably pretty good. We want this to be really quiet. So put this in raw waves and I'm gonna call it Burrow 1. 44 mono 16, cool. Thank you. Yeah, I don't know about this one. I guess I could save it. This might be a good unburrowing noise. I don't know, I'm gonna try without it first. Bro, two. Yeah, this one definitely does sound the most metallic of them all, most shovely. And I'm trying to isolate the parts that are shovely and take them out. It's like right here, kind of. I'm surprised that even worked. So, if anybody's watching this and I want to point out something that's really important about sound editing and stuff like that. What I'm doing here is I'm taking out parts of these noises, but this would not at all work with a tool like that doesn't snap to zero. So this tool here is called Audition, and it actually has snapping to zero turned on right now. So when I'm selecting a range of audio right here and I drop one end of it, it automatically readjusts my selection to snap to a zero crossing. So that I can go and I can delete sections, or I can even amplify, or you know, de-amplify, or whatever you want to call that, certain sections, and it keeps the audio clean. So if you're kind of following along with how this audio editing is going, just make sure to always, to know about zero crossings and to use them when you need to. All right, let's see how this sounds. Give the Zurub all these noises. I'm gonna duplicate all these also for the unburrow noise. Then I can change these to specific actual unburrow noises if I want. The behavior when it sequence burrow, animates burrow, sound burrow, and unburrow, sound unburrow. Let's see what we got. Hopefully that's the right keywords and everything. I always forget. And then it's going to be about the end of the stream for today. Yep. I'm not sure if I'll stream tomorrow. I normally stream about 5 days a week. About this time every time. Yes. It sounds good. It might be a little loud though, actually. It's surprising, but... just one that's sounding kind of annoying. I think it might be this one. Yeah, right here. Oh, okay. That one gets a negative 21. That one's like... Mm-hmm. Let's hear without that one sound. Yeah, so if I don't see you guys till a few days from now, I hope you all have a good holiday season, Christmas, Hanukkah, whatever your holiday is. Touch up these sounds. Pedro, what's up? Yeah, I'm just about to stop. Hope you're doing good though, man. Okay, so one of these noises. Is it that one? One of these needs to be a little quieter. I'm not sure though. I might just check all this in as it is. Yeah, so yeah, it was a good stream. Today I added poison. So enemies can be poisoned. They turn green, they leave trails of like acid, and then they get hit a few times and then they're unpoisoned. The player can be poisoned as well as the enemies. Jib can even be poisoned. But yeah, so that's it for today's stream. Yeah, have a good one. See you, Bailsen. See you, everybody. Happy holidays. Catch you next time.